With benchmark settlements such as the recent $10 billion Bayer deal to settle some 95,000 claims against Roundup weed killer, the topic of litigation is very much in the news. Today, NewsPoint welcomes Ed Truant, the CEO of Slingshot Capital. Slingshot is part of a handful of new firms focused on the high-growth area of litigation finance. Ed, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Sharon.
So tell us, what exactly is litigation finance?
So in essence, litigation finance is really a subset of a broader legal finance industry, which involves pretty much anything as it relates to finance interplaying with the legal community. Litigation finance specifically, as the name suggests, is a form of finance that has to do with backing pieces of litigation, and specifically allowing third parties to back that piece of litigation for the benefit of plaintiffs that may not have the monetary resources to pursue justice. And so it's really a form of non-recourse type of investing, which means it's completely contingent upon the outcome of the case. So if the plaintiff wins, then the litigation funder typically gets a certain percentage of proceeds of the outcome. And if the plaintiff loses, then the litigation funder loses their investment. Another way to think about it is really a form of risk sharing between the funder on the one hand and either the plaintiff on the other hand, or in the context of law firms that are working on a contingent fee basis, the law firm could also be the beneficiary of this risk sharing relationship. And then, but ultimately it does depend on the outcome of the case and whether that's by a settlement or via a trial win or what have you.
So what do you think is contributing to the popularity of this litigation market, both for investors and for law firms?
Yeah, the answer to that is multifaceted. And it's while there's some current wins that are supporting litigation finance, it's really rooted back almost 20 years ago. And really, it stems from a pain point that exists within all justice systems globally. And that pain point is access to justice. And so what happened over the course of time, as you can imagine, especially in the US where you've got litigation costs increasing 9% per annum, which is quite significant. And that has created this great divide between the haves and the have-nots, with the large corporations having the resources to pursue litigation and or defend themselves, and the have-nots being the smaller corporations and in certain cases involving class actions, individuals that don't have the resources. And so justice systems have looked at this issue and said, listen, we need a solution to this problem. And so there are certain common law doctrines called champerty, maintenance, and baretry that had heretofore prevented litigation, third-party litigation funding from occurring. And so more and more often, justice systems are putting aside those old common law doctrines as they're no longer relevant. We have much more legislation, much more regulation in place today to prevent some of the abuses that were happening. This goes back to the medieval times. And so they're now allowing third parties to enjoin themselves to other people's litigation and ultimately make a profit from it. So it started with a pain point that legal systems have identified. And then what happened was one system after the other looked to the Australian market as a precedent and said, well, they've solved the problem over there. Why don't we look at addressing it in our own jurisdiction? So the UK followed, the US followed, Canada is there. More and more recently, Hong Kong has allowed litigation financing within insolvency disputes, which is actually one of the starts of the whole litigation financing industry. And similarly, Singapore has allowed it in international arbitrations. And so it's really a global trend. It's now represents about $15 billion of available capital across US, UK, and Australia. So a fairly significant market size, small but growing. And interestingly, where it started in sort of David versus Goliath transactions, now what's happened is general counsels of large corporations have looked at the success of it and said, well, why don't we apply that to our own businesses? And so what's happening is you're starting to get these, what are referred to as corporate portfolios, where, I'm the general counsel to XYZ Corporation. I may have 10 plaintiff side cases. I don't have time and I don't have the money to deal with them. now I'm looking at litigation financing, saying, you know what, let me get a second set of eyes to look at this to make sure they're worth pursuing, number one. And number two, why don't I use an off-balance sheet form of financing that doesn't impair my own cash flow? And so it's becoming more and more increasingly a tool used by big business. So that's sort of the infrastructure part of it. What's happened more recently is predicated on awareness, and then surely followed thereafter by usage. And so as more and more lawyers have become aware of litigation finance as a business tool, they've started to apply it in their practices. They've started to recommend it to their clients, and we're seeing an increase in awareness and therefore an increase in usage. And then the third part, which is I think is perhaps one of the most important aspects of litigation finance, is that the recommendation rates from lawyers once they've used it is something in the order of 99%. So clearly it's a highly effective form of finance that lawyers are very comfortable recommending to their clients. And so those are some things that are happening more recently. I would also say from an investor perspective, what you're seeing is, you know, 20 years ago, there weren't a lot of empirical results data for investors to justify investing in the asset class. And so what happened at that time was you got high risk capital, high net worth individuals, family offices, those types of folks that came in. They took on, I would say, extraordinary risk, but it was by virtue of their approach to the marketplace that they helped validate the marketplace. Now there's a sufficient amount of data in the marketplace that larger institutions, Apollo Group as an example, are getting involved in litigation finance because they are comfortable with the empirical results that have transpired to date. So that's also helped attract capital to the marketplace. The other thing is it's a non-correlated asset class, meaning that it doesn't, the results don't tend to be influenced by the financial markets. And especially with today's current volatility in the COVID-led crisis and all the rest of it, if you're a pension plan or a large institutional investor, you're looking for, you may be looking for ways to invest in a non-correlated way. So that's very important as well. And I think the most recent trend that supports litigation finance is the fact that I view it as one of the most impactful form of impact investing. And so what I mean by that is impact investing has financial benefits, but it also has to have some sort of social, societal, governance benefits. And I can't think of an asset class that performs as well as litigation finance as it relates to impact investing. And there's plenty of examples of that happening. So on the one hand, you're seeing demand increase for all the reasons I outlined. And in lockstep with that, you're seeing investor demand increase as well.
So tell us what your approach is in terms of making litigation finance work for everybody, for plaintiffs, for law firms, and for the investors.
Sure. Well, for me, I've been an investor in the global commercial litigation finance market now for about 5 years. And by virtue of having that exposure, I've spoken to managers as far as South Africa to Australia and everywhere in between. And by virtue of having those conversations, getting access to data rooms and undertaking due diligence, I've had a tremendous exposure to a variety of different strategies, a variety of different legal jurisdictions, all of which have their own unique nuances in terms of volatility of returns, duration of cases, operating costs that are perhaps inherent in one jurisdiction but not in another. And so I think what I bring to the table for investors is really a global perspective and more so a finite perspective in terms of a particular fund manager's strategy to the marketplace. And so what I'm working on now is designing a fund really geared towards institutional investors. And the idea there is to allow them to get access to the asset class in a low cost manner and also in a low risk way of doing so. And so that the strategy tends to be highly, highly diversified. And so, from my perspective, I think what I bring to the table is sort of a global perspective on litigation finance and all the relationships I've created during that period of time. I'm very much data-centric in just sort of who I am. And so, I like to think what I want to create is sort of the money ball approach to litigation finance, which is deeply rooted in data. But that data transcends just numbers. It also means I understand at a grassroots level you know, what the managers are doing, how are lawyers responding to certain funders in the marketplace, who's moving from one out of one funder into the next funder, because all of those elements of data, while they're not structured, they are highly, highly insightful in terms of allowing me to make better investment decisions. And so that's really what I'm trying to focus on. And really it's the underlying premise is, you know, let me try to get institutional investors access to a non-correlated asset class that allows them to fulfill some of their ESG or impact investing mandates.
Well, we talked about the Bear settlement off the top. Did litigation finance play a role in this settlement?
Yes, absolutely. You know, Bear's a great example. So that Bear's in the class action realm of commercial litigation finance. But it is a primary example of how litigation finance is used to the benefit of plaintiffs. And in that case, that is a series of plaintiffs who, unfortunately, their health has deteriorated as a result of a product that was in the marketplace as a result of Monsanto at the time and now part of Bayer. And so litigation finance came in and got involved in two different ways. On the one hand, they were buying claims from plaintiffs directly, and that provided the plaintiff with some cash flow to perhaps deal with certain healthcare issues and healthcare costs. And on the other hand, they were providing capital to the law firms that were working on a contingent fee basis to allow them to pursue the cases. And that resulted in a tremendous win for plaintiffs. And we saw that recently in some of the headlines.
Well, it's an interesting and no doubt a growing market, a subject we're sure to hear much more about. Ed Truant, we thank you so much for taking time from your busy schedule to share the information with us today.
Thank you very much. Have a great day.